Grumpy Old Women by Judith Holder, read by Alison Steadman. Grumpy old women are a little bit older than they were. They're a little bit fed up, quite a lot fed up actually. And this audiobook is dedicated to this hitherto silent majority of women of a certain age who find the whole business of being a grown-up infinitely harder than they had imagined. Age itself is irrelevant. They may look a teensy bit middle-aged on the outside, but on the inside they are the young, fragile and entirely irresponsible women they were in their 20s. Only these days they share a special serenity and wisdom that means they are nearly always right. So how does it feel to be a grumpy old woman? Well, for a start, it seems like only yesterday that you were raving it up to 10cc in the Bay City Rollers. Only 5 minutes since you were scrutinising the problem page in Jackie magazine to try to glean more information about the docking procedure of sexual intercourse. And no time at all since you were doing your hair in flipbacks like Charlie's Angels. But then look what happened. You got older and a little bit fatter. And suddenly you got grumpy. Boy, you got grumpy. And now just about anything gets you in a bad mood. You thought you were about to mellow as you got older, but the truth is that these days you are boiling mad. All the time. And in the following chapters, we'll be looking at a small selection of the seemingly countless things that make us grumpy, which is just about everyone and everything. So let's start with some of the physical attributes that go with the territory. Some of the things that we see in the mirror or in the holiday photos that cheese us off and get us very grumpy indeed. Let's look at our bodies. Part 1. From hot pants to hot flushes. My entire body is turning into my mother's. I now look so old that if I was stupid enough to go into a nightclub, people would assume I was an undercover policewoman. Just like my mother, every bit of my body is either sagging or bulging or both. I'm sprouting some of those bobbly, warty things on my nose and chin that look just like the ones they sell in fancy dress shops for Halloween parties. Is there any bit of my body that doesn't need a spot of structural repair? Even my feet are getting all idiosyncratic. My toes are growing in odd directions. My toenails are so hard and horny that I've had to buy a pair of those nail scissors that could cut old chickens in half. And open-toed sandals are a no-go area. And my boobs, oh my God. It's like someone is inflating them with the thing we take camping to blow up the sleeping bags. Slowly but surely, they expand every month. If I did try to burn me bra these days, I might have to call the fire brigade. And then there's knickers. Sorry, I mean pants. High leg, low leg, pull in, pull out. What's a middle-aged girl to do for the best? Corrective underwear is what, as long as you're not going on a hot date. All those lovely sex kitten cute underwear shops with teeny-weeny bras and fancy strappy knickers and sexy bitch ranges are no longer for me. I imagine if I went into one of those shops, they'd say they didn't have anything in my size without even looking. Just as well I'm not thinking of having an affair, isn't it? It would have to be seriously dark. Everything's gone to pot. Even my knees are going all saggy and droopy. And never mind cellulite on the backs of my thighs. I now have it on the front too. Facial hair is a real and constant battle. The worst thing is a sudden shaft of sunlight and a mirror. So you have several choices. You can go to the beautician's every week for the foreseeable future and have some hideous course of electrolysis or laser treatment that will clog up your diary and set you back hundreds of pounds, or you can buy one of the home waxing kits they sell at Boots. I followed the instructions to a T. But even I could see that if I got this wrong, I could be walking round with first-degree burns on my top lip during the annual sales conference. I put it in the microwave as instructed, walked oh so carefully upstairs to the bedroom mirror with it, and gently pasted it on my upper lip and chin with a stick that looked like the one supplied with ice cream tubs at the pictures. Trouble is, I couldn't get the stuff off, and then it all hardened, which it's not supposed to, and it took me a good hour of excruciating pain to pick it all off bit by bit with a pair of tweezers. There was no big satisfying rip like it promises on the packet. I think I managed to nuke about 3 hairs after hours of agony, and ended up with a bright red top lip that looked like I'd drunk too much Ribena. Great. Middle age, of course, also affects your middle. The old midriff bulge makes an appearance and you get a nasty paunch. If you're wearing something floaty, people glance down at it and wonder, just for a second, whether it might be that you're pregnant, but then realise the statistical improbability and assume, more accurately, you just like your food too much. You wear a pair of shorts, and now they ride up your crotch and your legs rub together. I suppose you should have known better than to wear shorts at all. Your upper arms go all Mrs. Mills and flop about when you wave someone goodbye or shake out the duvet. So, unless you can set aside an hour's weightlifting every day, sleeveless T-shirts are out. And all this structural repair that your body needs takes so long. Even brushing your teeth is high maintenance. You can't just brush your teeth and get on with your day. You have to get out all the surgical implements the hygienist flogged you. Flosses, tapes, little brushes for between your crowns, buffers and pokers to get your gums in shape and to maintain all your root canal work. By the time you've tweezed out your beard and done all the dental work, you can count on at least an hour before you even get downstairs in the morning. Then there's your corns to scrape, your yoga to do and your eyebrows to pluck. None of this was going to happen to you, but then it does. Not because of anything you consciously do or don't do, it just happens. And with luck, you're married to a grumpy old man with man breasts and sticky out hairs on his shoulders, and it doesn't seem so damned important. It's not as if you can just knuckle down to a big box of Quality Street and turn into Peggy Mount as your mother did, with no one batting an eyelid. These days, you have to try and retain your figure by spending hours in the gym, then spend hours at the hairdresser's trying to recreate your natural, or should I say original, hair colour, assuming you can still remember it. People say, "You look well," which is code for, "You look a bit fat." And you buy those big necklaces to cunningly divert people's attention from your larger boobs and chin. When you have your photo taken, you have to suck your tummy in, and when they come back you think, you forgot to. Wrinkles you were expecting, but your face starts to go all saggy round the jowls. You get battle scar pock marks and splodges on your skin, and that grumpy look begins to take hold. On a bad day, you stare at yourself in the mirror and think that people might say you have the face you deserve, which is undoubtedly not a very pretty one. You could spend your entire salary on skin care. Time was when a tub of Nivea was as complicated as it got. Now you have to buy cleansers, toners, night cream, day cream, stabilisers and all manner of quasi-scientific products that sound as though they could double as biological weapons. You are now so cynical about all these skincare products that cost about £100 a pop that you wonder whether a dollop of flora on both cheeks might be just as effective. You don't know what to do for the best. As fellow grumpy old woman Catherine Flett remarks, "I don't actually inhabit my body anymore. At some point, somebody came along, body snatched, gave me this. It's the kind of body I used to look at on beaches and think, goodness me, how does that happen? How could you let yourself go like that?" That's how it happens. It just happens. Too true. You consider drastic measures to hold back the tide of physical decay. You buy one of those abdominal exercisers that sit on the bedroom floor and trip people up and snag their ankles and eventually work their way into the corner and then into the spare room before finally being advertised in the local paper and then taken down to the car boot sale. You could go in for some Botox, or try never to smile or laugh again. Might be surprisingly achievable, in fact. To ensure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.